Hello friends, my name is Shivam from DevOps Schools and I will help you to enable your learning process in various technologies of DevOps, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data and many more. This is our initiative to help you by sharing multiple tutorials and videos. And if you want any specific tutorials on any particular topic, then please do comment in the below comment section and I will help you with it. Also, please subscribe to our premium services on YouTube, which will give you access to more content and videos to enhance your knowledge about all these topics. Also, if you want me to help you with regards to the online trainings and classroom sessions by our qualified trainers, then please write me at contact@devopsschool.com. Thank you.
Yeah, so today I'm going to introduce you a world of monitoring and observability. So what is monitoring? I think most of us know about that. That's the reason you guys have opted for this session, right? Monitoring, you want to monitor, but what? Some of the services, some of the systems, some of the platforms, you know, virtual machines, infrastructure, networking, CPU, RAM, your applications, logs. You want to monitor it, right? So you want to monitor it because you want to measure their reliability, whether they are up and not up, is up the services or server is up and up or not. So these are the reasons we use a monitoring. Now if you look at this here, in the monitoring pyramid, we have a monitoring and then some incident get responded, then incident get responded, that means you monitor the system, then you get the incident, then you post-mortem or root cause analysis. On top of that, you do the testing, some sort of capacity planning, development and product fixing and sort of it. So these are the typical pyramid, but monitoring is dead. Yes, monitoring is dead. So nowadays we do not do the monitoring. So what do we do? So we are doing observability today. Nowadays we are doing observability. Now what is the difference between monitoring and observability? We need to understand. So once the monitoring used to be once upon a time, but observability is a superset of monitoring. Yeah, that means observability includes monitoring. It's a superset of monitoring and it provides not only the high level overviews of the system health, which monitoring anyway is doing, but also highly granular insight into the implicit failure modes of the system. That means the root cause for the failures and also fixes, everything they are providing you. In addition, an observable system furnishes ample context about its inner working. Inner working means the internal of the system, which monitoring is not detecting, but observability, you can get it. When I say inner working, that means you can get a logs also. You can get a performance matrices from the each services also. So like that, that's called inner working. Unlocking the ability to uncover the deeper and systematic issues to fix it. So these are the things you can do in the observability. So in a simple way, we are not doing only the monitoring. Okay, we are doing the monitoring. We have a great in-depth information about the system, how it works and all, and also fixing that issue also with the help of observability. So monitoring, on the other hand, is the best suited to reports the overall health of the system and to derive the alerts. That was the job of the monitoring. So monitoring tells you whether a system is working, but observability let you ask why is not working. So that's a difference between monitoring and observability. Okay, so this is the stuff which we have. Now, if you look at this, the more differences. So here you see here, anticipating the future, dependencies analysis, profiling, debugging, overview and alerting. These are the things we do. Out of which, alerting and overview is a part of the monitoring, which is a proactive. But in observability, you have anticipating the future also. That means you are anticipating, you are predicting the failures actually. It's not like failure has happened, because monitoring will do the alerting when the failure has happened. But here you are anticipating also. You're doing the dependency analysis also. Here you are doing the profiling also, debugging also, and all stuff like that. Okay. Call him. I'm just messaging rather than wasting this chat. Okay. So like this. Okay. So alerting, overview, debugging, profiling, dependency analysis, anticipating the future, and stuff like that. So again, if you want to understand a little bit of observability here, so all possible permutations of full and partial failures, it can get you through observability. So here you do the testing plus best effort simulation of the failure modes, and then monitoring predictable failures. So these are the observability. So in a nutshell, if I say observability means assembling all the fragments from logs. Mind it here, I'm saying logs. Now I'm getting into the technical word. Observability means assembling means putting up all things together, all fragments from logs. Logs means log monitoring tools, different tools, and organize them in a such a way which gives you actionable knowledge of the whole environment, thus creating an insight. So everything you capture it, the logs, matrices, events from the different systems and different tools, and the system which helps you to create actionable knowledge in a certain environment, that's called observability. Okay, so observability is important. So monitoring system should address two questions: what's broken and why it's broken. But observability covers the larger scope. Monitoring is mainly used in the terms of metrics monitoring. In summary, observability is a property of a system, and monitoring is an activity we perform on a system. Okay, so now the question is, okay, fine, we are talking about the world of observability now, not a monitoring. So what are the data, what are the types of data the system should produce so we can absorb those systems? I mean, so the data, the server, the application, the network, the data centers, anything, what kind of data they should produce so we can absorb them with the help of our different tools. So health check is one of the data we should produce, whether the system is up and running or not, like such as HTTP endpoints and stuff like that. Matrices, when I say here, like CPU, RAMs, hard disk, network, this, that, these are the called matrices. So systems should produce matrices, okay? And so you can observe them. Log entries make system logs, network logs, applications logs, and many other logs, log entries. So they represent a discrete events and all other information about the application systems and all, you should be producing it. And your system should be able to gather data in a distributed end-to-end tracing information also. Tracing means what? Distributed tracing means, remember here, if you know the software architecture, nowadays we do not run application in one server. We run in hundreds of servers. But also you must understand that these servers are not only running few applications. Now earlier we had a SOA concept, service oriented architecture. Now we have a microservices concept. So we run in the container and Kubernetes and all stuff like that. So multiple services we run in the same server also. And we have a thousands of servers like that. And the architecture of the software is based on the microservices. So we have to trace that which communication is going where and what are the response time which has been taken from the which request. Okay, so all this thing also we have to monitor. That's called APM typically. Okay, so these are the data you should produce to make the system observability. These things we call it telemetry. This health checks, metrics, logs, and tracing, typically we call it a telemetry. So telemetry is one of the very popular keyword which we use in the world of observability. So telemetry is a collection of measurement or the other data at the remote point and their automated transmissions through receiving equipments for monitoring. So the word is derived from the Greek root called tele means remote and metron means measure. So measure the remote endpoints to grab some information such as logs, entry or matrices or traces, tracings and all stuff like that. So which are the component we have in the telemetry? We have matrices, events, logs and traces. In short, I'll tell you this, we call it a melt. But if you monitor the melt, means you have a monitoring for matrices, you have a monitoring for events, you have monitoring for logs, you have monitoring for traces, then you can set up a observable system rather than monitoring. So here we are going to focus on these four areas of Neuralink: events, logs, traces and matrices. So matrices, typically we call it infra monitoring. Events, we call it sort of infra monitoring plus RUM and stuff like that. Logs, we call it log monitoring. Traces, we call it APM monitoring, performance monitoring. Okay, by the way, Neuralink is very popularly known for APM only. Later on, they added all these features to monitor the infra and logs and all of the stuff like that. Okay, so typically we call it melt. So while doing these exercises in Neuralink, we'll be working with it, melt. Okay, so what is observability now? So in terms of technicality, if you understand, observability means logging plus monitoring plus tracing plus visualization together, it's called monitoring. Logging, monitoring, log monitoring, monitoring, infra monitoring, tracing, APM and visualizations means dashboarding and alerting. So all things putting together, you can build observability. Did you understand that, guys? Now, what is the meaning of observability? Any question?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, so now you need to understand hierarchies of observability. And now let me tell you, this is a very, very important slides. Okay, look at this very carefully. Here, downside you have a faster, lower side you have a slower, and this is divided into the past, present and prediction, means past, the current thing, and the prediction means future. Now for the past, what you can do, so you can do the tracing and logging. Tracing means, understand that tracing data is being generated only if the request has gone to your website, some application, then only you can get the tracing, right? That's the past events. Logging also, a log is being generated only if that work has been completed, something has happened in the system and application, so logs will be generating. So that's called past work, that's called tracing and logging. So that you can use it for diagnostic, okay, and Neuralink will help you. Present data is like a matrices. Present data means current CPU utilization, current RAM utilization, current traffic, current hard disk, current network. All this thing is a present data, so that you would like to see on dashboard. Here there's no much of the things you can do here, but dashboarding, you want to monitor it, everything. And then here there is one keyword which is added: prediction. Based on the data which you have in the matrices, tracings and logging, you can have a some sort of forecasting also, which you call it signals for the future or stats for the future. And to detect the security loopholes or some visualizing the future use cases and stuff like that, many things you can detect, that is called detection. So all these things together, we can do it in a observability hierarchy. So yep, three pillars of observability: metrics, traces, logs. Metrics, typically we call it in the world of infrastructure monitoring. Traces, we call it APM. APM means application performance monitoring, and logs, log monitoring. These are the three pillars of observability. So but the problem here is, it's very easy to discuss, okay, we are doing not a monitoring, we are not setting up the monitoring, but we are setting up everything: past, present, future, everything we are able to analyze, we are able to visualize, and we are able to observe the things with the help of these other data types. But the question is it very easy? No. Look at the how we are evolving over the period of time. You know that this is something which is nothing new. Earlier we were running this system in the physical servers, then we migrated to the cloud, then hybrid, and nowadays we are running application in the containers. So now see the evolution of the platform. These are the platform, how we have migrated from, you know, homegrown to containers. So it's become so complex. Earlier we were happy with the 2, 3, 5, 10 machines. Now we have in a data center 10,000 container running. So imagine, just visualize that, from 10,000 container you want to get a matrix, you want to get a traces, you want to get a logs, put it up together at one place and analyze that some meaningful information out of it. So it's become hard, right? Understand this. But not only this, platform has got evolved, our architecture also had got evolved. So you know that how we have transformed. So earlier we were having monolithic means like MS Office in your laptop right now, which you have everything, you have so many components, so many software functionality which you have bundled it together in one, and you have to monitor only one system. That's called monolithic. But over the period of time, with the internet growing growth, we got the service oriented concept, SOA, service oriented architecture. So there we have a web server, app server, database server concept and all stuff like that. But now that is also gone. Now we have a not a one service like a web service or app service. We have hundreds of service, and each services we have hundreds of container, and each of these services talking to each other to serve only one request and one response. Understand this. Okay, so that concept is being called as a microservices. There are certain videos is already available in the LMS. You can check it out if you have access. Microservices and containers and stuff like that, so you can get used to it. So this is the architecture. So because of this evolution, it's very difficult to set up a observability. Very challenging to set up a observability. Okay, see here. So earlier we were only monitoring one system. Now we are observing so many systems, so many systems, so many servers, so many VMs, so many containers, so many applications, so many layers and stuff like that, and then putting up all this together and then setting up the observability. Okay, so it's very challenging. So now you should know what New Relic can do and how New Relic can help you. So here, as I have been noticing, if you want to set up an observability system, you have to monitor traces, matrices and logs. So traces, which talks about the relationship between the events, typically you call it APM, performance management. Matrices, the measurement of an event such as CPU, RAM and stuff like that. And logs, which is a human readable event. So here, all these three things here, New Relic is providing to you. Yes, New Relic will provide you in terms of traces, matrices and logs. Everywhere New Relic can help you. But let me tell you here, if you look at the New Relic from now and the 5 years before that, what they had released, New Relic got popular because of APM functionality. Now New Relic is offering every sort of services to make the system observable, including infra, log, security, RAM, browser, and many things, synthetics, many things they are offering. Okay, so this is the introduction about the New Relic and then related systems. Did you understand, all of you? Any questions so far? Any questions so far, guys?
This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. So now we are going to focus on the New Relic introduction and its component and terminologies. Okay, so we understand that in today's world, it's all about the digital experience. Okay, so digital experience means your system should be up and running 24/7 without even single second of downtime, highly available, highly scalable, highly reliable. That's called digital experience, and which is again is a brand experience nowadays. Like you see, the Google is always available. Any other sites you open is always available. So it has to be available. So to create a digital experience and brand, it's very important to make the system observability. So wherever there is a problem, you should be able to fix it. So yes, when you set up a digital experience for the customers, you have to have your mobile, websites, IoT devices, in-store kiosk and support call. Everything has to be in sync with each other. And poor digital experience risk your customers with a backslash, something like you may end up losing your customers, bad feedback, and so many issues will come. Again, these are some of the data which has been taken from the different sources. Now, if the digital experience of the Amazon.com is impacting only 1% of, in terms of 100 millisecond of latency, the sales of Amazon is dropped by 1%. Look at this here. Okay, a half second delay in the page load drop visitors traffic by 20% in by Google. And here, increase the conversion rate for the every second of performance improvement by 2%. So this is the impact of digital experience. So now let's talk about the Neuralink. So Neuralink will help you to set up one of the best digital experience for the customer by setting up the observable systems. It's one of the company which is listed in the New York Exchange, New York Stock Exchange in 2014, have a 15,000 plus client, and they're able to do that more than 1.4 billion events and matrices, able to process it per minute. They have a 1500 plus global enterprises, 12,000 plus disruptors, small startup companies also they are using it. So this is the things. So now what is the history of Neuralink? So basically there is one guy named with Liu Cirne. Now he founded the Willy technology in 1998. As part of the Willy technology, there were so many software which was developed for the performance management, such as JProfilers, JProp, YourKit, CA Profilers, and all. Now, CA is another company which acquired the Willy technology in 2006. And after that, Liu Cirne found the Neuralink in 2008. Okay. And now, if you look at this, AT&T is the largest account of the Neuralink, is using Neuralink in 2019 at the $1 million per year. Okay, there are so many other users also. So Neuralink in the today's world is into everything. So now this slide is very important. Let's understand that. Do you want to know your application is up or not? That's called availability. Neuralink will help you. Do you want to know network is up or not? That's also called availability. Neuralink will help you. Do you want to know server is it up or not? That's also we call it a new availability, and Neuralink will help you. Now, do you want to know your application is slow or network is slow or server is slow? Neuralink will help you. By the way, Neuralink is leader in this. Mind it, we call it a APM, application performance management. Also, do you want to know application is broken or network is broken or server is broken? Neuralink will help you. So everywhere Neuralink will help you, and so Neuralink will be the best component for the observability setup. So what are the component of Neuralink? So here you see the same slides. It can help you everywhere. So Neuralink has a many features. Okay. Many features. Neuralink has APMs for performance management. Neuralink has a mobile for RUM. Neuralink has servers for info monitoring. Neuralink browser, PPM, synthetics, platform, insights, many things. And every features of Neuralink With the help of that, you analyze the different matrices, logs, traces, store it. So basically you look at the bottom section. From the different places, you collect what? Matrices, logs, traces. Store where? New Relic. And from the New Relic, with the help of the different application, again is a hosted solution, you can do the work. You can work on the monitoring, you can see the trends, you can predict the future, everything you can do that. Okay, so here these are the component and this is the architecture of New Relic. Again, so you see that these are the systems, again same way in a different. So logs monitoring is there, metrics and traces is there, applied science is there, serverless monitoring is also possible, browser monitoring, mobile monitoring, synthetics, APM and infrastructure. So as part of this session, I'll be teaching you every sort of monitoring. Okay, every sort of monitoring. We'll start with the infra or APM and then we'll get into the H and everything slowly. Okay, any questions anyone have, guys, so far?
Clear so far, Rajesh.
Okay, so how can we get started, guys? So let me tell you, one of the beauty of New Relic is you don't have to install and configure servers like we do in the Splunk for log monitoring. You can set up a server, though you have a cloud Splunk also, but yeah, New Relic is a completely cloud-based application. Everything is hosted at one place. That's called, that website is called newrelic.com. You can get a 30 days trial period and that's more than sufficient for learning all the features. Okay, so maybe after this call you will enroll for 30 days trial period and you get a license and stuff like that. Now you can try all this through these 30 days. You will try all these features, and also there is a kit also which you call it SDK, software development kit. So if you want to customize New Relic agent to a certain extent, some scripting and all, you can download and work with it. And now you can also use Chef, Puppet and Ansible for scaling the New Relic. What does that mean? So see here, typically I'm talking about right now infra monitoring. Let's say for infra monitoring, you have to install the New Relic agent in all the servers, all the VMs and stuff like that. But you know what, this number of server in today's environment is more than 100, 200, 300, 500 and all. So am I going to install the New Relic agent, configure it, troubleshoot all this thing? Am I going to do in all 100, 200 servers myself manually? No. So for that purpose, if you want to manage a multiple servers and their New Relic agent and then their configuration, and you want to modify their configuration every day, so the best way would be to use Chef or Puppet or Ansible. Okay, so this is the best ways to do that. So Ansible is the most preferred one in this year and last year because it's become very popular. Puppet is also good, Chef is also good. So yes, is to set up, you can register online 30 days trial and then remaining things will do that. Okay, so in terms of pricing, I think it's varies, and again this slides I think will change because the pricing changes very frequently, so you have to match up with this. And though you don't worry about the pricing because you are learning a platform right now, so but yep, you should understand some of the things which will help your organization to save lots of cost. So if you want to have a data, telemetry data means MELT, remember four kind of data which I was talking about, telemetry data platform. So here it's a free up to the 100 GB per month. Okay, and after that you have to pay for $0.25 per GB ingested beyond the free limit. There is a free limit 100 GB per month. Now in terms of, if you want to set up a New Relic, is again as I said is an observability platform. So if you want to set up a full stack of observability, so this standard one, pro and enterprise, these are the three things you have it. Now what are the difference between these, you can study a little bit later. Prices also are differs here. So these are the three features which you have for full stack observability: standard, pro and enterprises. Because we are having trial versions, we'll be having access to Zoom.
To watch our complete session, enroll for our premium membership. Click onto the join button and enroll yourself with the best suited option.
To all of it, but for 30 days. Okay, applied science is not coming under full stack observability. So you have a two offer here, proactive detection and intelligence detection. Again, you can see the charges over there. So, yep. So the 10 key capabilities of New Relic is to set up a real time instrumentation analytics, flexible instrumentation and dashboarding, guides appropriate engineer responses, and correlate application performance to end user experiences, connect applications and infrastructure performance, rich detailed transaction data, real time error analysis on demand, diagnostics tools, integration with the DevOps tooling like ShapePuppet and Ansible, I talked about it, cloud service instrumentation and build to scale. So these are the 10 capability. Now, some of the slides, I'll just skip it. Yeah. So these are the component which you have, and I would request you all to hardcore your mind with this. So we have a browser, New Relic browser, New Relic mobile, New Relic synthetic, New Relic APM, New Relic infrastructure. And if you want to extend the feature of New Relic, New Relic plugin. We will start with New Relic infrastructure. Okay. So these are the component of New Relic we need to learn so we can set up our observability systems, observable systems in your organization. So browser, New Relic browser, let's start with the New Relic infra, which basically track configuration changes, event, search across the system inventory, correlate issues across the cloud and hybrid infrastructure environment. Remember, it's cloud also and hybrid also infrastructure environment. So infra monitoring, like server monitoring, network monitoring, CPU, RAM, and stuff like that. You want to monitor cloud monitoring, all this thing infra. APM, we call it application performance monitoring. Deep automatic application service visibility and mapping to fix slow transaction and service bottleneck. Synthetics basically is being used for the service uptime, proactively track service uptime to meet up the SLAs and all key transactions from the multiple global directions with automations. A mobile, you want to check that how's the experience in the mobile. So identify crashes, network performance bottlenecks, problems, problematic mobile operating system versions and other stuff. Browser experience. So in using that, you will install the some JavaScript at the browser and then we'll monitor the end user experiences of our application. So everything you have it at one place, and this all these component we call it together New Relic One. What we call it, guys? What we call it?
New Relic One.
One, yes. So earlier, you know, they had a separate services, but now they have added it into one, and that's called New Relic One. So everything's coming together and make it New Relic One. So
One question, Rajesh, for API's status that is going up and down, that is also done through this same New Relic, the last option
synthetic.
You showed on synthetics.
Synthetic. Okay. That's called synthetics. Any endpoint monitoring is done by synthetics.
Okay.
So all this thing we'll learn. Again, I'm not spending too much of time again because we will get into that each and everything one by one. So yes, get comfortable. These are the things I'll be teaching you. So New Relic APM, browser, synthetics, again, infrastructure, and ultimately you have to sign up. So all these things together, we call it New Relic One. Here it is. This is your dashboard. I think this image I have captured 5-6 months old. Little bit of changes will be there. So okay, so everything New Relic One has everything. You see that this image, New Relic One has a dashboard. Look at this entity explorer. I'll show you that what you can explore with APM, browser, synthetics, mobile, infrastructure, log, alerts, and applied artificial intelligence, and many more. Security in the more type, we have a security and all that. So this is a thing. Once you monitor something like that, you will see. So what is a New Relic One? Yep, New Relic One let you find, visualize, understand everything that's happening across your software environment, cut through complexity and provide the context, see across artificial in organizational boundaries, quickly finding and fixing the problems which you have. Okay, so now we will get into the third slides. So these are the systems we have. Now I would like to ask to you only rather than me deciding. So we have all this component. So should we get started with the infrastructure or APM? These two are very important. What do you think? Should we start with the infrastructure?
Infrastructure, yes. I mean, the others can also.
Yeah, you can start with infrastructure. Thank you.
Yes, infrastructure, Rajesh.
Yeah, infrastructure. Yeah. Please start with infrastructure.
Okay, so yeah, let's get started. So, guys, now let's start with infrastructure. So what I will do, we have again, let's say 1 hour of discussions and all, and we have spent a lot of time already. So let's do some demo also today. So what I will do, I'll do the infrastructure only, but not discussion. I will do some of the stuff. Let me write it so that way we'll get comfortable. So step number one, I'll share all these notes with you. Step number one, register at Neuralink website. Okay, that's for 30 days trial period, you get it. Second thing, step number two is I'm going to create one VMs, okay, in AWS. Now why I'm having one VMs, you can have VMs anywhere in AWS, Google Cloud, Azure, you can have it in your laptop also, virtual machines. No, nowadays no one is using the physical machines, so you can have a VMs. And after that, step number three, okay, install New Relic infra agent in that particular VM. Fourth, step number four, visualize VMs matrices. I said matrices, remember there are three words I'll be using, you have to mind it. Matrices for infra, traces for APM, and logs for log monitoring. So matrices, VMs matrices on New Relic.
Is that step four or step three?
New Relic one. Okay, so this is the step number four. Okay, so these are the things I'll show you now, and again the recordings will be available, so let's check it out. So let's get started. So first thing, I'm going to register with New Relic website. Okay, so here I'm going to register now, sign up, anything. See, observability made simple. So no more monitoring discussion. Now let's have an email ID, Rajesh Kumar. Rajesh, I don't remember that this email ID, have used it or not in the past. So let's check it out. And it's taking little time. Yeah, so I'm going to disable the screen sharing because I required to access my email address. And do you have email from New Relic? Let's check it out. I'm just waiting for an email. Let me stop the recordings also.
This conference will now be recorded.
I use Linux. Okay.
So here. Yeah. So I got this here. So let's set up the account. Save the password. And now here step number one is done. I would say it's done. So now this account I can use it for next 30 days. Now, which place where you are would like to set up a data center? I mean, whatever the data you store, do you have two options? Either you stored in those data in the Europe and United States. Only these two options are available. Typically, United States, save. So this is setting up your account. After that, step number two, what I'm going to do is create one VMs in AWS. That's called infrastructure monitoring. But before that, I would like to little bit of you get comfortable with the dashboard of New Relic One. This is New Relic One, which you can see on the screen. Now, you know what? This is they are saying, because it's the first time you are doing all installations. So they are saying, okay, do one thing, install the infrastructure agent, logs, ingestions and all. So it's like a sort of quick guide actually. So if you want to do that, you can do it very well. Linux, Windows, Docker, Kubernetes, and see all the installation options that are coming. And there's some noise coming from someone. Balaji, would like to mute yourself?
Sure.
Yeah. So yeah. So here you can monitor any of these things. By the way, let me tell you, even though if you skip it here, all these steps, you can do it later. So right now I'm selecting Linux. Okay, so Linux, how do you install the infrastructure agent? So now this command they have given it to you. Look at this. This command you can get it later point of time also. And you must understand this. This is one of the script which you are going to run it, and it has all the logic. Now this script requires some input, and that input is like New Relic API key. This key is very important actually. And remember, each account you register, you get the API key. And because of this key only, that your agent will be able to send the data to the New Relic cloud. If this key is not valid, then you will not be able to send the data to the cloud. Again, and this is your account ID. So this is my account ID, this is a New Relic ID, and these are the commands consolidated in one place. So now this command, I'm going to run it in one of the VMs, which I have it, I'll be creating it in the AWS. So let me create one VMs just for the demo. So I have a AWS here, and I'm going to create a one VMs quickly just for the demos. So you can check this my screen.
Sorry, when you say VM, you mean EC2?
Correct? EC2, yeah. VM is okay. VM is a virtual machine. On AWS we call it EC2. On Azure we call it virtual machines. On Google Cloud we call it instance again. So okay. It's the same thing.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just creating one instance. Just hold on for a second.
Yeah.
One question, Rajesh, when we download these agents, say on a network firewall perspective, are there any ports, etc. to consider? Because if this download gets blocked or something.
So this is outgoing, remember, outgoing. Okay. So typically outgoing, you don't block it, right? Not incoming.
I think no, are there particular ports? Is it standard HTTPS or something?
Okay, that's what I'm saying. Okay, let me explain it to you, then we'll understand. See here. Where is my paint? Sorry. So let's understand this way. This is your VM, okay? And here you have an agent installed, okay? Agent is running in these machines. Now, this agent need not to be accessing from outside, so port is not needed here, though there are some internal port is also there which is being used, that's collector port. I'll discuss this one later on. I'm not going to complicate, but look at this here. This agent is collecting all the data internally from the different sources through the collector and sending and forwarding to the cloud, New Relic cloud. So the access point is here, not here. So they are collecting internally all the data and sending to this cloud. Okay. Getting on points?
Yeah.
So for example, I'll put it in this way. You are browsing an internet, www.google.com. So for that, do you have any port as such? No. Because outgoing is open all the time. But yeah, many times outgoing also will be blocked. So for that, there are certain scenarios. New Relic APIs, you have to create into the whitelist. So those are the things we'll complicate a little bit later.
Okay. Yeah, because maybe later when you go into that in depth, that would be something very important for us.
Yeah, we'll do that. Yeah, I'm not complicating right now the agent specification, sure, sure, because agent itself is having 3-4 component: collector, forwarders, and UDP port and all. You have so many things. So
yeah, sure.
I'm not sure why this AWS is stuck. I'm clicking, but it's not slow. Okay, so I have one virtual machines already. So instead of creating the virtual machines, I'm going to reuse that one. So let me grab the IP address. That way it will save some time. This is little slow. I don't know why. It's taking too much of time. Are you finding a difficulty is me hearing you guys? I mean, hearing out, my audio is and screen is good?
Yeah, it's perfect.
It's good. I can see. Okay,
then must be a problem.
Yeah.
Yeah. So guys, I have got the one instance already, which I am going to use it. So I'm going to log in through the PuTTY. I have a keys. I do not have a password. You know that AWS EC2 instance provide the keys. So this instance, I'm going to log.
Yeah. About this using PuTTY, you have to show us how to do it. You know, because I can create the EC2 instance, but how to connect it with PuTTY. So you don't have to go through the, maybe you can share that knowledge. You understand what I mean?
Yeah. So I'm sharing this recording with you after this session, but also because you have asked this thing, so I'll share one of my blogs also for this. Okay. I assume you know how to use AWS and all, but let me share my blogs, otherwise I'll forget.
Yeah.
So how to log in, see here, how to log in Linux server from AWS from Windows using PuTTY. So this tutorial I'm sharing with you in the chat window after this training, which you can refer it. Okay,
thank you very much.
So guys, I have this is CentOS, so my login ID is CentOS and key I have already provided, and this can be any VMs. For the sake of discussions, it can be any VMs. It can be in your laptop also. Now I'll become a root. I have a very bad habit to become a root, though it's a sudo enabled. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this command. Okay, so now you see, I'll show you this command here. New Relic is not there in this machine. I'll just validate. You see there's no New Relic is there. Enter. It will not take more than 30 seconds to get it. Everything is done. So the script is automated and fully full-fledged script to get it installed, the New Relic agent. We call it infra agent, by the way. Okay, so okay, so it's being installed. Just wait for a few more seconds. Almost done.
So it installed four things infrastructure again looks Docker and JMX also.
Basically, these are the client which got enabled. So I'll talk about this one little later. I'm not complicating the stuff. Actually, it's got installed only for time being the agent, but they enabled some of the things along with it. So why this stupid screen is coming, I don't know. Okay, this may take time. So just wait for it. That we call it a client libraries. Now, what is a client libraries in agent? I'll discuss a little bit later because we have a more than 300 integration available in the New Relic Infra agent. So everything can be enabled. There are certain things which is enabled by default, and that is what they were talking about here. I think I lost that screen.
Because when I installed it, it only do one thing, not four. So if it's possible, you know how to enable all, then I can.
You can. I'll teach you how to enable Docker monitoring, how to enable the log monitoring, how to enable API monitoring. All these things are part of the sessions. One by one, I'll teach you.
Okay.
Okay, so I think this a different message, but I think it's done. The following will be installed and success files has been found at this. It's taking too much time actually. Not sure why. This kind of things you should not get it. I don't know why I'm getting it. Checking the data, this may take few minutes. So I'll go to my New Relic website. And
maybe
here
Ubuntu is better.
So see here, infrastructure agent they have detected. So I can see that infrastructure agent has been given. Now you can see here, from here the data is being sent out. Just wait for a few seconds more. And you can see the bottom section of the part which is getting loaded. Let me show you here. Snipping. See my cursor somewhere, it's checking out. And okay, I am surprised. It's a 8 GB machines actually. It's taking too much of time. Yeah, almost done. Okay, so so now the agent got installed. See here, New Relic installation is complete. And now let's check the New Relic here. See here. Now you can see that New Relic has been running. See, this is the infra service. This is the infra, and this is a Fluentd logging. So all this thing we'll discuss in detail when we deep dive into the infrastructure. So now for time being, it's up. Infrastructure is set up. Now all the data infrastructure agent will be sending to the New Relic in a few seconds, and then we'll be able to enjoy that. Basically CPU, RAM, disk, network, and a few more things. So I have refreshed this. I'm still waiting for that. You can see that this cross shine. So I'm still waiting for it. Maybe that New Relic website is a little bit in the load, so it's not processing very fast. I'll just pause the recording.
This conference will now be recorded.
Yes. So now I have accessed the New Relic one in the new tab, and I was able to access, and then I clicked on the infrastructure. And if I click the infrastructure, I see the one host added. Now this is the rich dashboard which you have got it. And now all the data I'm getting it here. It took some time because maybe it's a new account or something. But yeah, CPU low, CPU utilization, load average for each 5 minutes, memories, and many other things. You can see that. Okay, so here is the system. Here you have a network, network load, all this network information. Here you have a processes. Now processes, I have to check whether I enabled or not. And yes, I think it's enabled by default. This part of, you can disable it also. This is a storage, and let me tell you here, a Docker container, they have detected, I guess. Why? I did not enable it, but they have detected. Now, but how can we enable and disable manually Docker container? I'll teach you later. But what has happened, I'll tell you. In my machine, the one which I was trying, it had a Docker process already running. So because of that, I remember there was somewhere they asked while installing, Docker is detected, you'd like to enable that monitoring? And I press enter, means yes. So you see the Docker monitoring also, Docker container monitoring also, you got enabled. So how many container do you have? Look at my screen here. Let me show you here. I have one container and two containers. So two container is running. You can see here two container Confluence and some Postgres, which you can see here. This is some Postgres and this is the Postgres. Okay, sorry, Confluence. So where is this? Confluence and some Postgres. So there are two containers. So container is also monitoring. So now this data which you are getting is basically current data, present data. Okay, so this data, we call it a matrices. Now the main thing is, we have installed the agent, we are getting the data, we need to be comfortable with all this UI part. And also we need to understand how to customize this agent which you have in the etc New Relic infra. This is the location. So whole things we need to understand here, integration.d and logging.d. if I go to the integration.d, these are the files which you have. Logging.d, these are the files which you have. So now we have to understand each one of every files and get into that and then customize it. So this is the introduction of New Relic along with the installations of New Relic infrastructure and using that New Relic one for seeing the stuff. Did you understand that? Any questions so far?
What is the environment? What is the environment required to practice?
This, as I said, you need to have a few VMs. That's all. Few VMs, yeah, that you could have in your laptop or in any of the cloud you have accounts, AWS, Azure, Google Cloud. That's all you needed. Nothing else. When I say few laptops, means one Linux and one Windows is sufficient for you.
Yeah, I have a lot of assets for AWS, but I have one question where you ask the logs that you showed us now, the infrastructure log. You know, if when you are doing, can we go back to the log, please, where you show the log, the other logs, please? Yeah, you have two logs here with the ls command, integrations.d and logging.d. Now, if somebody have problem during installation, can this log help you to know what the problem is? Any of these logs?
No. Okay. This is different. Okay, let me put it in a simple way. Here. Okay. Understand that I have let me make it visual so that will be easy for me. This is your VM, virtual machines. Okay,
yeah,
this is virtual machine, and here you have an agent installed. Just now I installed the agent. Now you would like to know where, which is the agent file which is installed. So just grab this, you'll get immediately. This is the infra agent which has been installed. Now what this agent is doing, now this agent is installed and running, but this agent has no information about what data to be sent. I repeat, this agent is not knowing what data to be sent. So we inform by default, okay, agent, please pick up the CPU, please pick up the RAM, please pick up the Docker services, please pick up the something else. So we notify, we pick up this log, we pick up this log, and all this thing consolidate and send it to the New Relic cloud. Okay. So now the question was, what is this? You said, what is this? So basically this integration.d and a logging.d is a way to tell this agent, I want
to watch our complete session, enroll for our premium membership. Click on to the join button and enroll yourself with the best suited option.
To send this data from this machine to New Relic. Got it?
This is crypto.
Like that we have a 300 integration available in a New Relic, like Apache data I want to send, Tomcat data I want to send, MySQL data I want to send, Docker data I want to send, anything you want to send, there's an integration available. Log data you want to send, Fluent is a default log monitoring tool, but so many other things also you can set it up. But the question, if you are asking, okay, where do you see the agent log? Where do we see the agent log? So for that, you have to go to var log. And here you see the, see here, New Relic infra. And here you see the logs. Right now, there's no logs. Why? Because the agent is not enabled in the verbose debug mode. That's the reason you're not getting any logs. So you can enable it. And this location, you get a log for agent.
Okay.
Got it?
Can we cut this to see what is inside? Can we cut it?
What is that?
If you want to see what is, because sometimes some people, for example, now they want to install MySQL, you know, in New Relic One, and he get an error because he cannot install it. So if you want to check what is the problem, why he get error, why he can't install it, you need to know a log where you can see what the problem is or not, or you don't do that.
Yeah, so that's a topic which we will cover, that New Relic agent troubleshooting. That's, we have a sessions for it. So I have not discussed anything about the agent. I have not discussed anything about your agent. Just made it you comfortable, because I was having just running through the slides, so I felt like not to run too much, and then some demo and stuff.
Good. Thank you. It's good. It's good. I'm happy with that. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, guys. So, any other questions if you have?
Along with that, you can access our other tutorials such as Docker, Ansible, Jenkins, Terraform, Splunk, AWS, Azure, and various other DevOps-related premium tutorials with our channel membership. If you would have any issues with our channel membership, you can drop an email to us at contact@devopschool.com, or you can also unsubscribe from channel membership anytime if you don't want to continue or did not like the video. To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the $3.99 plan, and grow your skills immensely.
Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries. We will reply to them at the earliest.
Thanks for watching.